No recovery without citizens. It's the topic of the webinar. My name is Anelia Stefanova. I'm a CBank Watch Network Energy Transformation Strategic Area Leader. And I'm pleased to have you here today with us presenting our recent report, which will be launched right after the webinar, on the how recovery funds are used to support green transition. This webinar, just for your information, would be recorded and then shared with all the participants. We are very much happy to have you today because it's a very important and relevant topic for us as part of our coalition called Citizens Observatory for Green Deal Financing. We are launching together the report, which is aimed to look at more specifically how the EU funds and the recovery funds specifically are spent in the last year. Our coalition is formed by 9 organizations in 7 countries, and which with the main aim to look at the what and how recovery is going on, and if the citizens are involved in the decision-making about the public funds use in the local level. We are currently having one of the biggest chance in our life to mobilize more than 2 trillion euros across Europe for more resilient and sustainable future of the Europe. And our coalition came together very much inspired by the Green Deal objective to make Europe as the first climate neutral continent by 2050. And we wanted to look more and more how exactly this is happening locally on the local level. So we will have during the webinar some of the policy analysis we made over the last month, but also some of the good examples. So examples about how the funds are spent. So I really hope you have a very interesting discussion and also opportunity to have questions and discuss what is next on the recovery. So please use the Q&A opportunity of the webinar. We will be responding to all your questions after the presentations. I wanted to just share the names of the organizations which are part of this this work. We have, as I said, 9 countries, 9 members involved in that, Bankwatch and Counterbalance, jointly coordinating the project, and our member groups from Hungary, National Society for Conservationists, Estonian Green Movement, Green Liberty, Polish Green Network, Recommon, ODG, Zazemiata, are our partners and also working very much on looking at how the recovery work is done in the respective countries. So I want to present you shortly the panel of today. First, we would have a presentation about the analysis and also overview of some of our recommendations for how we see the recovery should be changed in the future. Then we will get done by Daniel Thompson, EU Policy Officer for Biodiversity in CBank Watch Network. Then we'll zoom into the InvestEU and the EIB financing, which is also it's a complementary part of the recovery fund, and it's also aimed to deliver around half of 1/3 of the funding for the green transition allocated by the EU, which will be presented by Frank Vanderhoff, the Director of Counterbalance. We'll then zoom in the two cases from Italy and Latvia. The first one is about the unsustainable breakwater in Genova, presented by Eva Pastorelli, national campaigner in Recommon, Italy. And we'll close the presentation rounds with the flood and risk mitigation infrastructure in Latvia, presented by Walter Skina, national campaigner in Liberty, Latvia. Without further delay, I just also to save more time for more discussion, I would give now the floor to Daniel Thompson to present the report and also guide us to some of the recommendations we elaborated. Daniel,
yes. Thank you, Anelia, and a warm welcome from my side. So yes, I'd just like to present some of the main findings from the report and specifically talk about why public participation in decision-making is so important, taking their context in the context of their EU recovery funds and explain a bit about, unfortunately, how there's been a lack of public involvement in these in this process, and what are some of the practical implications of not having proper public involvement. So what we're seeing in terms of what's being financed as a result of this lack of public involvement. So I'd like to start just by outlining why we think citizens, why it's so important that citizens are involved in both designing and implementing public investments. Now, just to start with very broadly speaking, as obvious as this may sound, but let's not forget that this is actually public money. The key recipients and the key targets here should be ensuring that public's needs and interests and priorities are really reflected in this public money. They should really have the right to determine how their money is actually spent. I think it's easy to forget this, but as I said, this is public money, and it should really be in the hands of the public to decide where and what is being financed using this public money. Now, public participation, I think, is really important because it means that their spending needs are aligned and reflect the actual needs and interests and priorities of the citizens. I think taking the case of the EU recovery funds, when it was first announced a few years ago, the whole idea of the EU recovery funds wasn't just to recover economically from the pandemic, but the whole idea was that we need to recover in a green and sustainable and look kind of beyond business as usual and what we previously had, and really kind of strive for greater ambition and to build some real long-term resilience using the EU recovery funds. Now, here it's important to think about public participation and really having the public engaged and properly reflecting their needs, because the purpose of the recovery fund was really to invest in, for example, new and transformative areas. So the broader the input, the greater the ambition and alignment is with the intended goals. What we've seen a lot of the recovery funds is just recycling previous investments that were kind of planned even prior to the pandemic. But to really have this more greater ambition, what we need is greater stakeholder input to really raise the level of ambition here. It's also vital to ensure, for example, public ownership. So people are much more likely to understand why a specific project is actually being financed if they're involved in the planning and in the implementation. So it's really a key way to make sure that the public do have ownership of these funds, and public participation is really a key to ensuring this. And then there's also the issue of monitoring and providing proper oversight and scrutiny. So I think, as I'll present shortly in the next several slides, there's really an issue with the lack of proper monitoring mechanisms that are currently in place to make sure that the funds are actually going to the right areas. And here it's really the involvement of citizens to make sure that these funds are actually going into the right areas and they're far more likely to care and want to actually monitor how the projects are being implemented. And so here it's really key to ensuring that the funds meet the intended objectives and align with the real purpose of the recovery funds, which was to build kind of long-term resilience and build back better, as the EU puts it when they first announced this. Next slide, please. So as important as public participation is, it also means we need proper transparency. So the two are slightly different, but they very much go hand in hand. So here it's really the right of the public to be clearly and comprehensively informed in a really easy to understand manner. So the citizens really should be kept informed. And here we see it really important that there's proper information provided by the EU and also by the national authorities, to make sure this information is properly out there and that citizens can and do have access to it. There are a few reasons why this is important, but I think one of the main issues is that it really allows the public to hold their public authorities and the member states to account. So it really allows, for example, the public to judge for themselves whether or not their governments are actually delivering for them and that their needs are actually being met. So in order to do so, we really need greater transparency about what is actually being financed. And then lastly, there's also a need for not just companies and beneficiaries, but also people affected by the projects to be involved. So it really helps people to understand which projects have been financed and funded and why this is the case. So it really develops greater public acceptance about why these funds are being financed and what specific projects are being financed. So as well as the input that we received from 9 different civil society organizations working on 7 different countries, for this report, we also conducted a survey. So we wanted to understand what the public's views on the EU's recovery fund to kind of complement the direct experiences from their various civil society organizations that are working on this Green Deal initiative, on this Citizens Observatory for Green Deal financing. So as part of this report, we conducted a survey, a citizens' awareness of the EU Recovery Fund survey. We collected 178 responses from 24 countries. I think 21 were from the EU, so this represents most of the EU member states. And just to quickly go through what were some of the responses that we received from this survey, to really show the lack of kind of involvement and participation and transparency of the recovery funds as seen by EU citizens, the general public. So from the survey, 125 people out of 178 have heard of a recovery plan. In terms of how many know of a project though, only 64 out of 178 actually knew of a project that was financed, and 33 said they maybe know, so they weren't quite sure. In terms of how they would define their involvement, there are 2 questions. The first was, have you contributed to the design and implementation of the recovery in your country? 146 responses were generated here, saying that they weren't aware of, or that they haven't contributed to the design and implementation. And also the majority of respondents said that the level of involvement by EU citizens was poor in the design and implementation of the recovery funds. So this very much aligns with what we've seen as civil society organizations working specifically on the recovery funds over the last couple of years. What we've seen as civil society organizations is directly reflected in this survey. So if you could, next slide, please. Thank you. So just a few takeaways that we can see from the survey. There's obviously a clear lack of involvement and engagement by the public here, as reflected by the survey, and also a lack of understanding about what's actually being financed. And there's clearly issues of transparency and communication, the fact that so many people weren't actually aware of what projects are being financed, I think really speaks to the level of transparency and communication engagement of citizens in this whole recovery implementation and planning. So next slide, please. So just to quickly present some of the overall key findings that we've seen, again, having followed this from 9 of these different civil society organizations, having followed this process as well as the survey. So the question is the EU's recovery package actually delivering for citizens? And in general, it's our view that it's not, unfortunately. One of the key reasons behind this is because there's really a lack of public involvement and citizens' engagement in the recovery funds. So the fact that citizens aren't involved really means that what's being financed isn't reflecting their needs and priorities, unfortunately, that the recovery fund should have addressed. So one of the key things we've seen is that there's really a lack of ways that the public can actually be involved in monitoring the projects. So there's a lot of information, for example, on the EU portals, but these tend to be very superficial. And in terms of actually looking at specific projects that are financed in locations and how much money for specific projects is being allocated and who their final beneficiaries are, who the project promoters are. Well, this information is very, very hard to find. Is organizations, civil society organizations who are actually working on this for years, we've struggled to actually find concrete information about what's being financed. So if civil society organizations whose actual role it is to properly monitor this have trouble finding a lot of information, then it's really not a great sign. And the fact that the public really cannot find this either is not a good sign. We've also seen that a lot of there's a lack of monitoring tools and mechanisms in place. As it currently stands, one of the only real mechanisms in place is so-called monitoring committees. So these are spaces where various different stakeholders can meet and provide kind of monitor and scrutinize what's being invested. Unfortunately, these weren't mandatory as part of the EU recovery funds. Most member states have set these up, but unfortunately, in many cases, they're not very representative they don't really provide much space for the public to really provide input here. So in some cases, for example, there's only one environmental NGO who's represented in these monitoring committees. And in general, from our direct experience, these aren't really running very smoothly, and they're not functioning as they should be, which is very unfortunate given this is one of the main monitoring tools and mechanisms put in place. What we've also seen is that a lot of the funds have gone disproportionately to large corporations instead of actual medium and small sized companies or the public sector to meet some of the key needs of the public. So for example, specifically in the Mediterranean, we've seen problems with a lot of the funding going to either big consultancies. For example, in Spain, more than half of the grants and a third of the total recovery funding was spent on public-private partnerships led by big corporations. And then similarly in Greece, 622 million worth of loans be given to just 13 large companies and a consultancy firm. So instead of investments going to, for example, the public sector and things that actually could directly benefit citizens and represent their needs and interests, it's a lot of the funding has just gone to big companies and big consultancies as well to manage the EU funds. Next slide, please. So what are the consequences of not involving citizens? We've seen a lot of investments that unfortunately not reflecting the interests of the general public. And even worse, we're seeing investments, for example, directly in fossil fuel financing, investments that unfortunately fail to address biodiversity loss and in some cases actually further drive biodiversity loss. We've also seen overall lack of investments in public services and the focus still very much on big fast spending for big infrastructure projects, just to make sure that the funding is spent as quickly as possible. So a real focus on quantity rather than actual quality of projects being financed. And just to give just a few examples, I think colleagues will go into some of these examples further in depth, but just to give some quick examples, for example, in Czech Republic, there was 67 million spent on gas boilers. In Italy, in the port of Genoa, there's a huge mega infrastructure project to finance the breakwater expansion there, which is designed mainly for big cruise ships. I think my colleague Efe will talk about this shortly. In Spain, we're seeing a financing of a ski resort as in a protected area. Fortunately, we heard from the previous webinar that we ran that this has actually been prevented now, at least two of the projects. So this is the financing is no longer available for the most harmful of the projects here in Spain. And then also renewable energy projects in Estonia, which could be potentially be in sensitive areas in Estonia. So I think what we're seeing here is a lot of projects that if there was proper public involvement and participation at the very beginning, these kind of projects wouldn't have actually been financed. And it would really reduce the public opposition. Thank you. So just onto a few of the concrete recommendations. My colleague Frank will complement these during his presentation. But first and foremost, we really, really need to improve the transparency and availability of information. So what we'd really like to see is a much more comprehensive and harmonized platform of all the projects that have been financed and no view of the actual project beneficiaries. We really need greater transparency for people to actually monitor and to ensure better engagement of citizens with the recovery funds. And unfortunately, this hasn't been the case. And this information really has to be updated because in the few cases where there is some of this information, it's not kept up to date and things move very quickly. And so it's very, very hard for stakeholders, both civil society and the public, to actually properly influence and monitor and be kept up to date on what's being financed. And then lastly, there's, as we've discussed, we really see the need to strengthen the role of civil society and the public in monitoring and implementing the national plans. We're now, of course, in the implementation stage, and there's a huge amount of money that's currently being implemented, but with often a lack of actual monitoring mechanisms. So here we see the role of both the civil society and the public in actually making sure that these funds are properly invested and properly implemented. So one of the first recommendations we have is to actually ensure that the monitoring committees that I previously spoke about are properly implemented and functioning, and they're actually used as a bridge for the public to communicate some of the concerns that they have in terms of their projects that are being implemented. Another recommendation is to establish a complaints mechanism for citizens and civil society to raise cases of non-compliance. At the moment, it's very hard to challenge these specific cases, and in many cases, by the time these are actually raised by the commission, for example, often the damage is actually already done. So what I'd like to see is a dedicated complaints mechanism where the public and civil society can raise these cases, and they're investigated far more quickly, and the funds are withdrew if it's deemed not compliant with funds objectives or environmental legislation. And then lastly, what we'd like to see is greater cooperation between the public authorities and civil society. There's already been some success here with regards to the national-based commission staff, who are really kind of the bridge between the public authorities at the national level, who are responsible for implementing the funds, and civil society. And in the cases where they have been involved, this has worked very well. Unfortunately, this hasn't really been done to a large extent. So what I'd really like to see is the European Commission, for example, provide more technical and financial support so that the public authorities and civil society can really work together in a meaningful way. I think overall what we've seen is member states, public authorities seeing civil society and the public as a real kind of burden and just not really an asset in terms of helping make sure that their skills and knowledge and expertise are fully utilized. And what we'd really like to see is that they're deemed more of an asset. So it's really deemed a way for their funds to reflect their needs and also their interests and priorities, and make sure that the funds are actually properly implemented. So I think that's it from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you very much for guiding us through the report. And indeed, we started from the deficient framework of the recovery, which didn't allow for proper public participation. We are now 3 years after the instrument was launched. So we're really hoping to have a good discussion today also about what could be done now today about improving the recovery spending and really delivering on what are the objectives of the Green Deal. With that, I also want to encourage you once again to use the Q&A option in this chat. And moving straight forward to Frank. Frank, I wanted to, please guide us on what is your assessment on the InvestEU and EIB investments into the recovery. They are a key component of the new green, the Green Deal financing. So the floor is yours.
Okay. Hello, everybody. Gonna already pass to the next slide. Yes. So as Anelia already said, complementary to the recovery funds, we already also looked at the financing mechanisms that were put in place right before the recovery fund to finance the Green Deal. And this is InvestEU. And InvestEU is a mechanism which uses a combination of EU budget and the public financing capacity of public banks, mainly the European Investment Bank, but also other European or national public investment banks are participating in this project. And it's the way it works is that it's using these guarantees and public finance capacity to mobilize further investment, mostly by private companies or private investors. And in total, the goal is to mobilize 370 billion euros, and around one third of the whole project, the whole package, is destined for green sustainable infrastructure. So it's a big part of the financing of the Green Deal next to the recovery fund. One of the main findings that we had, and this is also a bit that was already covered a bit by Dan before, is that we see a lot of the money going to companies and banks who actually make a large profit and that are also often not necessarily in the projects, but the companies themselves in general that are implementing the projects, that they are still playing a very important role in climate destruction. And why is this issue of these large profits significant? It's because it means that a big part of the money that's actually the cheap public money that's being put available by the EU, this is going to actors in society that already have a lot of resources and that would be able to finance these projects that we want in our policy goals to reach the Green Deal or a recovery. They could do it by themselves, or it could be done through regulation, etc. And on the other hand, there's quite little attention for the basic needs. Maybe give a few examples of some of these companies. We found, for example, that the EIB in its energy financing since 2022, that it gave a big loan to Repsol, which is a Spanish oil and gas company that is still active in a lot of even the most unconventional oil and gas activities that are the most polluting of all, and doesn't have at all business model that is compatible with reaching climate goals. And then we have for another one, Société Générale, which is a big French bank, which is being used to implement a lot of the like smaller projects. And even though these projects themselves are, for example, for small scale renewable energy, and which things that as such could be interesting, are not bad projects. We see that this is, again, an example of using the public money to make these investments, these small-scale investments are often seen as less profitable, as less interesting for the market, that these players who made a lot of profits, multiple billion profits in 2022, also received a lot of this public financing to invest these projects. And that, on the other hand, where we see this is in the priorities of InvestEU and the EIB, we see that there is quite little attention for what are really important needs and that are important, like that there is a where you can have a high combination of reaching climate or environmental goals and tackling inequality and making sure citizens have access to crucial services like affordable housing and energy. And this is in the context, like, as of course we all know, of high inflation and the cost of living crisis, which started in 2022, the year we started, we analyzed the financing, and we really put a question mark here to say, like, is this really where the public investment capacity to finance a Green Deal that and a recovery that is said to leave no one behind, is this really where the money should be going priority in the highest priority? Then another thing that we saw is that there is a lack of transparency in the EIB projects. We see in the latest years, and there are more details in the report, of course, that the amount of projects that are being published before they are being signed on the EIB website, this is decreasing. Often, commercial interests are being used as a reason to not publish. And as well, either in InvestEU or the EIB, there is not really a chance for citizens to really be involved in the decision-making process of these investments or of the strategy. There is a complaints mechanism at the EIB in general, which also has important flaws, but what's really absent is this thing what Dan was also talking about for the recovery fund, these capabilities for citizens to really participate in the strategy and decision-making process. Next slide, please. Thank you. So then I go back to recommendations to continue where Dan left off. So one of the observations that we made that also already came a bit from Dan was that we see that these large companies and investors, they have a big amount of influence, control over where the EU public money for recovery and Green Deal is going. And there's a number of things that we think that can be done. And it is one thing is that it should not be up to the big private consultancy companies to define the national plans. Dan already mentioned the example of Spain, where we really saw that some of the big four consultancy firms played a big role in defining the plan, and which was actually a result of the earlier austerity from the years before that decreased the administrative capacity of the state to organize the planning of this program. And this is definitely not the way to go. We saw also conflicts of interest where some of these consultancy companies were advising their own corporate clients to finance projects. And then another thing is that what's really crucial is that not only can we, of course, have information on which companies are financing either be it the recovery funds, implementing the projects, be it in the recovery fund or through InvestEU or EIB, but actually also that we know better what are these contracts like who is taking which risk are we as a public guaranteeing for these companies or not. And that would actually be really good to know in terms of democratic accountability. What is this? How is this public money being used with these companies? In general, on the InvestEU and EIB, we advise that the strategy would be adapted and that the broader environmental crisis and inequality would have a much higher priority. As we saw, not only is there the problem that some of the client companies, etc., they are still doing many polluting activities. Some are even part of the big polluters internationally, but also that we see that biodiversity and other environmental concerns than climate, that they are really, really at the bottom of the priorities. And even though we know the science is clear that we really have to tackle this if we want to have an ecological system that supports us. And this is the same thing with inequality. This goes back to the point what I said about the low priority for affordable housing and energy, for example. We see that this is not clearly in the list of priorities. And it's important that these issues are being tackled. For example, the renovation of housing, social housing for lower incomes. Not only is this a necessary thing to do to reach the climate targets, but also if we want to reach the climate goals and if we want to have support for the climate and environmental agenda in broad parts of society, we need to make sure that there are solutions for them. This is very important to reflect in investment programs, because where these investments are made in the next coming years will have influences in the next decades. And then there was one more point which actually it's a bit related to the information on the contracts. It's that to be for these public investments to be really socially fair, what's really important is that corporate clients, corporate companies, and financial intermediaries, financial institutions, banks, investment funds, if they participate in projects, it's important that they also carry a risk for the project and that the public money is not being used to make sure that the projects respond to their expected markets profit returns, but that these companies actually also invest in the recovery, in the green transformation that we need. Now go to the next slide, please. Okay, and then we have a last set of recommendations which are more structural. And these are Dan already talked about some of these issues, but I go now with a little bit more the bird's eye view. Of course, we want that the citizen interests are at the heart of these investment programs. And this is why we say that the citizen participation and inequality have to be really a priority in all of the projects, in all of the investment programs. Then another one is that an important thing to do to make sure where are the most needs and what is not yet being financed now is that there should be an exercise of mapping these needs and make sure that the existing programs are adapted to make sure that money can go to compensate for the gaps that we have now. And in order to do this, it's most likely that there will be a need for extra financial resources to fill these gaps. And as you can see, for example, there is discussion now about the extra financial resources for the EU that will be discussed in the Council summit that will happen next week. And there is a lot of thing about technology, about strategic autonomy, etc. But these crucial needs of investments, they are not on the agenda right now. And this is very important to change if we want the citizens to benefit from this transition and that they also buy into this transformation that we need. Another thing that is really important and where a lot of the unrealized potential of public investment programs by the EU can be improved is to increase the cooperation between different public investors. So this can be European, use EU budgets, use recovery funds, use the public investment banks in combination with the national public investment banks or local public investment banks. Not necessarily, first of all, to decrease the risk for private investors, but to make sure that initiatives, projects that have below market returns, but that are very important to deliver for a just transition, that these can be financed. And then lastly, there is also a need for more administrative capacity, both at the national and local levels, for implementing the recovery programs. We see that, for example, quite some of the countries are not really investing all the funds. And there are some situations where, for example, either you have these consultancies playing a big role, or some countries or some local governments, they just don't really manage to have at the right time, in the right, with the good quality to develop projects. And this also means that if you want to improve such investment programs, that you have to make sure that the right amount of administrative capacity and resources are also human resources are available to proper plan and design these programs, and also to integrate the citizen participation in the decision-making process. So I guess that's it from my side. Yes. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks. Thank you very much for also emphasizing how difficult and challenging it is to change the investment flows. This is also one of the main conclusions of our report, that it's not enough just to earmark funding for the green transition. It is much more difficult indeed to engage and make sure that investment decisions are taken going in the right direction. And this is a very good introduction of the presentation which we'll make Eva about one of the projects which was in the drawer for a long time. It was a project which designed before the COVID started and was presented as a strategic opportunity as part of recovery plans, but we'll get now in a deeper dive if this is really the case. So Eva, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Anelia. Good morning, everyone. So giving a brief overview of the project, the new breakwater is the core part of a broader plan for restructuring and reorganizing the entire port of Genoa. It aims at allowing the dock of mega cruise ships and cargo ships to double the transport of containers. The breakwater will require highly complex engineering work, both in terms of size. You can picture it as an 11-story building about 6 kilometers long, so quite massive infrastructure, as well as offshore construction, because it will be the deepest breakwater ever constructed in the whole world. So it is the largest infrastructure project financed, as Anelia was saying, by the Italian government under the recovery plan. And its cost, initially estimated in 1.3 billion euros, has now risen over 2 billion euros. Next slide, please. So this project presents many risks. In terms of biodiversity, the construction work, together with the increase in maritime traffic, will pose a threat to the Mediterranean Sea, to its ecosystem, and it will interfere with the Pelagos Sanctuary Reserve for marine mammals. It will also generate an increment in carbon dioxide emissions from increased traffic, both in the city of Genoa and in the Mediterranean Sea. There is also a high risk, high economic risk in terms of cost of lost opportunity to invest in alternatives, together with negative impact on economic sectors such as fishing and tourism. Plus, the environmental disaster risk of this construction method has been well evidenced by the statements of the former technical director of the project management consulting team, engineer Piero Silva, who I would like to publicly thank for its commitment on the cause. And it has also been recently confirmed by the main public research institution of Italy, CNR. Next slide, please. In January 2021, the project was presented for the first time during a public debate. This was before the start of the environmental impact assessment process. According to the testimonies of environmental organizations and the public, the duration of the public debate was insufficient for them to assess the information provided by the developer. In fact, the documents were provided very late and in some cases not provided at all. Furthermore, for most of the time, very technical issues were addressed during the public debate, and very little space was given to the relationship between the port and the population, which is what the public was interested in. Moreover, the not at all option, and by this I mean not to be of the breakwater option, this was not even addressed. Next slide, please. So the project is one of 10 granted a simplified and fast-track approval process as part of a governmental decree intended to accelerate the implementation of Italy's National Recovery and Resilience Plan. This results in a fast-track environmental impact assessment, which halves the time required to obtain this assessment for recovery-funded projects. This new procedure includes a shorter period for stakeholders to provide comments on the environmental impact assessment that has been cut from 60 to 30 days. And in our case of Genoa, in this time frame, 30 days, only 2 observations were submitted by the 30-day deadline, and 1 observation was submitted after the deadline. This new procedure includes also a shorter period from 30 to 15 days for the submission of comments from the public following a request for additional information by the Ministry of Environment. In our case, only 1 comment was submitted within the deadline. Next slide, please. So, going to the consequences of this picture that I just show you, we consider this process to not be following the European requirements regarding public information and opportunities for public participation. This simplification and acceleration brought substantial gaps in the scope of the environmental impact assessment, failing to present the overall project impact on protected areas and marine species in the Gulf of Genoa, and in terms of increased maritime and inland traffic and pollution. The new Italian legislation on project financed by recovery funds has literally blocked citizens from having an adequate say on investment such as the Genoa breakwater. These under the guise of speeding up the process to meet investment deadlines, when we know that cutting the time is not the the answer to a lack of capabilities, as Frank was saying, of the public and local and public administration in dealing with this kind of project. This concern, repeatedly expressed by citizens, associations and experts, have not been considered or acknowledged by those responsible for the investment. So in conclusion, rather than seeing citizens' involvement as slowing down processes, institutions and politics should value citizens' contribution to the design of green, inclusive, and just societies. There is a real danger that profits for the few could prevail over the well-being of the citizens and the ecosystem, and this is one of the cases. But as Genoa citizens and the association have repeatedly asked, these funds, 2 billion euros, just to remember the amount of money, should more usefully be invested to promote activities, businesses, employment and services for a sustainable future for the current and future citizens, not only of Genoa, but of Liguria and Italy as a whole. Thank you. That is all from my side.
Thank you, Eva. I want to still remind you about the questions and answer session option in the chat. So please, if you have any questions, we will be glad to respond after the fourth presentation. And in case also we don't manage with the time, we also would be back to you in the written form. So without further delay, going to another major issue which is challenging us today, the climate adaptation, which we are more and more facing, the floods and floods prevention needs, and giving the floor to Valters about what is planned in Latvia and how this is in line with the climate change.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Yes. Great.
It's nice to be here and to present the Latvian case. Just a very, very quick remarks with reflection to what Dan said on the public participation in Latvia with regards to recovery and resilience facility. There are many great investments financed in the recovery and resilience facility in Latvia, including public green infrastructure. Few things I wanted to point out. As Dan mentioned, public participation. One of the main tools for public participation in this fund is a monitoring committee. In Latvia, we don't have one. So yeah, you can read more about that in the report. With regards to the other main aspect I wanted to emphasize, long gone are the times that we saw environment and nature as separate from economic activity and society's needs. We now look at them as a whole, and this particular investment, the investment in flood risk mitigation, is definitely connected, and there are significant risks that have arose due to climate change. The fact is that in the worst climate change scenarios, The financial losses caused by floods in the EU may increase by almost six times, and many more people will be affected by floods. And this amount of people every year could even triple, reaching 500,000 people each year. Yeah. Next slide, please. But at the same time, as I mentioned, we must see this issue as a whole. Within the Green Deal, there is a huge ambition to really use what nature provides us with, in the sense that also the nature provides ways to fight to adapt to climate change and to fight flooding, and that this is emphasized in many EU-level policy documents, including the EU strategy on adaptation on climate change, which emphasizes that green infrastructure is no regret solution, which can benefit both the environment and the people and the economies, while building climate resilience. And also the biodiversity strategy calls for restoration of free flowing rivers, primarily through the removal of barriers and the restoration of floodplains and wetlands. This is emphasized also in the floods directive, that basically the floodplains and wetlands are a natural way to decrease flooding in areas which are not supposed to flood. So the basic idea is to give rivers more space and so that the water has somewhere to go during high water levels. And this is also confirmed by a recent publication made by the EU Joint Research Center, that flood peaks using detention areas is economically one of the most attractive options. The research also included Latvia. Detention areas also include natural meandering rivers and also floodplains. These are all natural detention areas. Thank you. Next slide, please. So the case that I want to take you deeper in the case, which you can also read about in the report, is the flood risk mitigation infrastructure investment in Latvia, which is basically renovation of infrastructure which was built 60 to 80 years ago. These are regulated sections of rivers, basically channeled rivers or strengthened rivers. These are polder pump stations. These are protected dams. And it is true that many of these objects be renovated really serve an important role for keeping safe and keeping safe homes, but also many of them were built in a time where the value of natural rivers, the value of wetlands, the value of natural river flood mains wasn't recognized. And the climate experts also say that we basically have made a mistake by channeling so many rivers and building dams on so many rivers that the water doesn't accumulate. That the water doesn't accumulate and goes downstream very, very quickly. So this investment will diminish, according to the implementer, will diminish flood risks on 16,000 hectares until 2026. It must be emphasized that this area was diminished, and the amount of number of infrastructure objects was also reduced. Both due to increase in prices and also due to objections made by environmental NGOs, some of the objects were taken out. Nevertheless, this investment promises that the implementer promises that this investment will not have a negative impact on biodiversity and ecosystems, since green infrastructure solutions will be given priority. And that's basically the nutshell. Shall we go on? Yeah, thank you. And these are an illustration of how some of the objects look like. So we have channeled rivers. On the right up corner, there is even a canal that's going to be cleared. Huge areas are going to be cleared of canopy of trees, and the channel is going to be cleared. On the left upper corner, we see the protective dams that are going to be restored. And on the bottom, we see the pump stations that are going to be renovated. Next slide, please. And like I said, many of the objects do serve a significant purpose for flood risk mitigation. We really want to emphasize that the possibility to not fight nature, but to integrate nature in flood risk mitigation is largely lost. And this case of River Boluca illustrates that, although there is still much room for improvement and much possibility for improvement. So this is a river which was straightened out, channeled 60 years ago. On the picture on the right, you can see that now it's starting to regain its natural meanders. And it's connected to a Lubana wetland complex, which is a Ramsar site, which is a Natura 2000 site. And the foreseen works are basically mechanical removal of trees and other vegetation, massive clearing out of soil and biomass from the river bed, leveling out the dug biomass in the forests and grasslands next to the site. And there are significant areas of floodplains, also forest habitats. There are no major population centers nearby. And the situation at the moment is that it is clear that there will be some sort of environmental impact assessment, at least preliminary impact assessment. But we don't know yet the result, and we don't know how the end result will look. But we sincerely hope that EIAs will also give evaluation will also give opportunity for alternative solutions, and will evaluate alternative solutions. And we want to emphasize that this project has big potential for floodplain integration and could be a best practice green infrastructure case. Next slide, please. So the positive aspects of this investment in general, flood risk mitigation activities in Latvia in general, many of the projects do serve a significant or even critical role in flood risk mitigation. And also many objects at the beginning, when the investment was pushed through the public consultation, the objections raised by NGOs were taken into account, and multiple projects were removed from this investment due to risks for damage to Natura 2000 sites. At the same time, we still see this investment as a lost opportunity for nature restoration and also the European Green Deal, because there is no real ambition to integrate river meanders or wetlands in flood risk mitigation planning, as is emphasized in the many policy documents and the basic trend in the EU. One huge fallback is that no appropriate assessments were made in the recovery plan, in the original recovery plan on Natura 2000 sites, which are needed according to the Article 6.3 of the Habitats Directive. And there is lack of public consultation for individual flood mitigation projects. Maybe the pump stations and some of the other objects, maybe they don't need a large public consultation if it's just the renovation of the existing pump station infrastructure. At the same time, projects like Bolupe, which can change the environment hugely and can affect local areas and natural values hugely, that definitely do need a public consultation. Next slide, please.
Technical issue, because the webinar was scheduled until 12. We would stay 15 minutes to indeed respond to some of the questions. And if you could conclude with your conclusions.
This is the final slide. It's important for the national decision makers to revise and reconsider the existing drainage systems with fresh eyes and the integration of natural ecosystems into flood mitigation planning. It's important to adopt best practices from other floods flood risk mitigation projects in the EU, because there are many that combine nature with flood risk mitigation, with great infrastructure. And there has to be meaningful participation, not just the required baseline, but there has to be meaningful public participation for individual projects with significant effects on landscape and local communities. And some possibilities for improvement for the European Union and the
closer to the mic, pardon. We don't hear you.
Can you hear me now? Yeah. Just to finish off. So more guidelines and stricter demand for integration of natural ecosystems into EU financed flood mitigation projects, and requirement and funding for monitoring for impact water quality, EU habitats after the implementation. Currently there isn't much done in this area. Thank you.
Thank you. Digging into details, you see that there's more and more work necessary really to make the investment sustainable, and the citizens and civil society organizations, which are normally the bridge between citizens and decision makers, are a key element for that. I just wanted to share with you also our contacts if you have any further questions and information. And if you put the next slide, please, we are releasing today the report on the no recovery without citizens, giving more examples about why we need public involvement in the decision making from 7 countries. You see all of those in the report, including also recommendations. So without going further into the in that, I would want to move to the question and answer session. I'm sorry for having not leaving so much space for that. And now we would try to go through the questions which was brought into the Q&A function. The first one, which is, I guess, Dan and Frank could respond, is what is the window of opportunity now for this recommendation to actually be impacting the recovery programming and monitoring infrastructure? How do you plan to get these issues into the decision makers' agenda?
Maybe I could start with, then Frank can complement. I think it depends on the timeline of the project and whether or not the funds have actually been dispersed or not. For example, as it stands, a lot of the projects are looking to be financed in 2024, so I haven't actually received the financing yet. So I think here, it really depends on what the timeline for the disbursement of the funds is. In terms of what this means with the, for example, in terms of the monitoring committees, I think there's still time for improving the functioning of the monitoring committees and bringing better cooperation, as was one of the recommendations, between civil society and the project implementers, as Volt has touched upon on the Latvian example. But for example, if we can prove that the various projects don't comply with EU environmental legislation, and specifically the do no significant harm principle, then this is a legitimate reason for withdrawing the financing of the funds. As I mentioned on my presentation, there was this very recent case in Spain where there was the financing of a ski resort which went through a protected area. This managed to be stopped, so 2 of the projects have no longer received financing. So there is still time. It just very much depends on whether or not the individual project has or hasn't received financing. in terms of putting the issue on the media agenda, decision-making agenda. I think here it's really important to have like a bigger public opposition campaign and a media campaign to really raise the profile of specific projects, both with at the EU level and the national level. For example, this was a key strategy again of the Spanish case that recently got rejected. The finances was no longer dispersed. There was a big media campaign here, and that really seemed to help elevate the public opposition part here. So yeah, I think a strong public opposition in really media here is crucial. But there's also, of course, MEPs. So let's not forget that MEPs are there to kind of represent their constituents. And they also have a role in monitoring, scrutinizing what's being financed. The commission is, of course, the lead here, but they also have to listen to MEPs. So I think it's important to utilize the MEP and really write to them and raise concern when you see these issues of non-compliance. You can then raise these issues directly with the commission. So I think, MEPs also have a very strong role here. But also contacting the project implementers, again, as Voltis provided somewhat of a good example, where just getting in contact with the project promoter, project developer, and actually making sure that your views are represented there is also a key mechanism. But yeah, that as well as the monitoring committees, I think are a good approach.
Picking up from where Dan left off, I think there's two elements I want to stress is that apart from these more like these very specific points, it's also a matter of using the available space and political will. Because if you look both at the recovery funds and InvestEU as such, it's possible to focus. Nothing in the regulation makes it impossible to focus a lot more on the on some of these citizens' needs that are not being met right now. But it would imply that you politically intervene to put these higher on the agenda. For example, as we saw since the beginning of this year, a lot of political interventions have also been made because in the competition, geopolitical competition around green and security defense technology, a lot of European political decision makers have also put political pressure that green tech and support for industry would be higher on the agenda of public investments, amongst which also the European Investment Bank and the and unused recovery fund, for example. So that means that the same is also possible to do it for the needs of citizens. And this is why we also think that it's an important thing to as you say, to campaign on, to put political pressure from EU, from the bottom up, and which of course we are in a situation where we are approaching within a year European elections, and this is a very important topic for us on the agenda. Yes, that's maybe one last point I wanted to add is that. For the EIB itself, we just published, this was from after the publication of the report, but we also as counterbalance published just the week before for the shareholders, the board of governors of the bank, proposals of how they can increase their potential to deliver for the citizens for a just transition, and we think that they have a lot of unrealized potential to take on more risk to finance the kind of projects that we have been talking about. So if any person would be interested, we can share this material with you, of course.
Walters and Eva, also for you, what is to be still done in the
next 3 years, which is left for the recovery spending, where you see the opportunities?
May I go? Thank you, Nelia. What can still be done? Well, a lot. The work that we are doing within the Citizens Observatory is quite precious to to raise the voice of the local communities affected by the recovery projects, both in a positive and in a unfortunately negative way, likewise the case of Genoa. I think that by raising their concerns, considering that the Italian plan has not been properly assessed by the citizens, because we know the history that brought to the drafting process of the plan was not that transparent. And by this, I mean not transparent at all and not participated, we can still try to involve the citizens in the process of reviewing the plan. We know that there are ongoing dialogue and processes within the national government and the European Commission, and what can we do is to through the civil society and to the organized citizens, we can address the government and making it accountable for the decision that it is trying to make without even addressing us as citizens. And we can also, as we are doing, presenting to the European Commission and the European Commission and the various Directorate General, the issues that we see, because sometimes there is no willingness from our government side to listen to what we need in our societies in order to live a sustainable, better life, prosper life without burdening the environment even more than what we have done since now. So engaging with local communities, pushing the government and the institution to be accountable for this public money that they are given to our governments in order to be spent for recovery priorities, which are not profiting for the few, of course, but benefiting all, and start creating a networking of organization and mobilizing citizens and informed citizens, because transparency and data are what we need to understand and to make the plan as much readable and as much owned by the citizens as possible. Thanks for the question.
There's a question. If it's possible to share the report, I would ask one of the colleagues to help me with that. Wouters, any final remark?
Yeah, I just wanted to answer to Jana's to Jana's question. From the practical point of view, at least in the member states themselves, it is now up to the monitoring of the individual projects within these investments and trying to ensure that the do no significant harm principle is followed and all the promises made by the implementers are followed. At the same time, we're also giving recommendations to decision makers, to national decision makers, to ministries, and to EU decision makers, how this process can be improved. And in case if there is no public consultation involved or there is no real chance to officially or legally participate in consultation, then we act proactively and we send letters and raise our voice about specific projects and specific issues.
Thank you very much. Indeed, the Citizen Observatory was born with that idea to have a space for citizens from the countries we are covering, but not only, also for organizations which are going beyond the consortium, which is part of this project, which is financed from the Citizens Equality and Right Program of the European Union. So we want to have space for everybody who would like to share information about the cases and concerns related to the recovery plan's implementation to become more visible and heard also by the decision makers.
I wanted just to add to the final to the what my colleague said so far. Indeed, recovery comes not in the situation where we had a number of other crises perpetrating in Europe, the social aspects which Frank raised, and inequalities which were already there for many years, climate and biodiversity crises. So it's very crucial that this two trillion euro of European funding, which includes recovery, InvestEU, and EU budget, are really used in a proper way to make our climate, our planet, fit for climate change, and also stop and preventing certain trends which are there damaging and could be causing further disasters. So we hope through the work specifically now and more on the Repower Europe chapters, that many of the things which were not properly addressed in the recovery plans decision making could be still discussed with the Commission, be watched out by the members of the European Parliament, and would be raised by the civil society, so we could improve the recovery plans, and they could be also an example. And I'm sure they are, and we are also releasing a website with more than 100 examples of the recovery measures which are going across the different CEE region, which shows that there are very good examples which could be multiplied, could be promoted further. And in the same time, we need to prevent that public funds are used in a way that it could be damaging for the environment and for people, but also that they are spent in a not very transformative way, because we really need them to unlock the transformation which Europe needs for the delivering on the Green Deal objectives. So thank you very much for the webinar, being with us all the time and over the time. And we will share the presentations and also the registration with all the participants registered. Have a nice rest of the day.